If we're ever going to explore and eventually colonize the galaxy, we're going to need functioning propulsion systems to do it. This goes for the nearest star or the other side of the Milky Way. So here are 10 hypothetical interstellar propulsion systems we might someday use to travel interstellar space. Number 10. Light sails. Light sails, at their simplest, are sails that function not on wind, but on light pressure. Lasers stationed on Earth or in space can exert pressure on sails. Sails in general are ancient ideas, and we have lasers. So, out of all of the entries on this list, we are closest to realizing this one. In fact, there are multiple programs looking to build and use laser-driven light sails, including Breakthrough Starshot, which looks to send a swarm of microprobes attached to light sails to Alpha Centauri at as much as 20% of the speed of light and get them there in just 2 to 3 decades. However, scaling this up to manned capability presents significant challenges, but as a means of exploring nearby stars, if programs like Breakthrough Starshot are successful, interstellar exploration may begin within the lifetimes of people alive today. Though one could argue we're already doing that, using instruments from Voyager to study the conditions of the fringes of the interstellar medium. Number 9. Nuclear pulse propulsion. Over the decades, there have been several proposals to build spacecraft accelerated by nuclear detonations to reach high enough speeds for realistic interstellar travel. The concept is simple. Build a spacecraft with a blast shield at the back, and then periodically drop nuclear bombs out the back of the ship, detonate them, and that in turn pushes the spacecraft along. Increasing public distaste for nuclear projects and nuclear test bans sidelined work in the field of nuclear pulse propulsion. But it does provide us with a future means of interstellar travel. And nuclear detonations in space aren't the problem that they are here on Earth. Space is already full of sources of radiation. The launching materials off Earth to fuel such a spacecraft does pose risk, as is often pointed out when NASA launches radioactive isotope-powered probes such as the Curiosity rover. This type of propulsion is, in principle, something that our current technology is close to being able to do. Number 8. Starseed. This option is effectively a nanoprobe gun. Using a 1,000-kilometer-long hollow tube lined with electrodes, exploratory nanomachines could then be electrostatically launched at very high speed, up to 1/3 of the speed of light. This puts a one-way trip to the Alpha Centauri system at roughly 13.5 years. That's fast, and the main advantage is that researchers sending these kinds of probes would get to see the fruits of their research within their lifetime. There are two downsides to this method, however. Number one would be the tube itself. Given its length, the tube would be difficult to keep straight, and would need to be kept well away from gravitational sources in space to keep the nanomachines from impacting the tube while being accelerated. It's likely that the materials needed to create this are yet to be fully developed. The other issue is that nanotechnology is still generally in its infancy, so this method lays at least decades off. But one can also imagine many types of hypothetical nanoprobes, such as modular devices that assemble into a larger probe upon reaching their destination, or von Neumann probes that can self-replicate on site, or build custom equipment without having to return to Earth. How far this scales up, or if this could ever be used to do more, such as custom 3D printout humans on site to colonize a planet, remains to be seen in the relatively far future. Number 7. No hurry propulsion and Dyson Slingshot. As it stands, at currently attainable speeds, it would take our current rocket-based technologies centuries to get to the nearest star system. Voyager 2, for example, will need 42,000 years before it will come close to another star, and it's only 10 light-years away. But over vast amounts of time, hundreds of thousands to millions of years, the galaxy shrinks and can be fully colonized in terms of a few million years at slower speeds. If you have that kind of time, or you're in a situation such as a multi-generational ship built, say, from an asteroid, then slower methods can be used. Other possibilities include powerful rockets launched not from Earth, but from space, and also gravitational slingshotting. But if you chose your destination wisely, you can do much more with this than you might think. The concept of Dyson's slingshot comes into play. If you can get to a certain type of binary system, such as closely orbiting white dwarfs or even binary neutron stars, these types of systems can be moving very rapidly. Some of that energy can be imparted to a spacecraft passing close by and slingshotted out on a new trajectory at much higher relativistic speeds. In other words, it may take you a while to get to a binary neutron star system, but once you're there, you're on your way much faster to wherever you wish to go. Number 6. Nuclear fusion drives. Fusion always seems to be right around the corner, and has been for decades. But recent developments may be changing that status quo. While large fusion reactors like what might be developed from megaprojects like ITER wouldn't seem useful in space until decades at least from now, there is a lesser known, somewhat more secretive project that may yield results much sooner. It's the compact or high beta fusion reactor being developed by Lockheed Martin Skunk Works. If that project works out, fusion could not just finally be right around the corner, but the reactor would be small enough to launch into space. If that ends up being the case, and if the idea works, that would allow energy generation in space on unheard of scales. The International Space Station, for example, has about 75 to 90 kilowatts available to it generated by an acre of solar panels. High beta fusion reactors would produce 100 or more megawatts, enough to run a large city, yet be about the size of a city bus. With that kind of power available, goodbye ISS, hello Battlestar Galactica. There are several ways to use fusion as a propulsion system. One is direct thrust created by the fusion reaction, and another would be to generate electricity for the various electric methods of producing thrust, such as ion drives, plasma drives, photonic drives, and so on. Number 5, the Anti-Matter Valkyrie. Imagine being able to travel at 92% of the speed of light, and then when you need it, have the means to slow back down. And unlike some hypothetical faster-than-light methods of propulsion using exotic forms of matter, this one can be done with a material we've already created here on Earth, though it's perhaps the most costly material on Earth to produce, antimatter. Assuming that antimatter in the future can be created in sufficient quantities efficiently enough to make it worth it, you could build the Valkyrie. How this works is that you create a small matter-antimatter reaction, and the exhaust from their total annihilation pushes you along. Then, you add more antimatter, on the order of 100 tons or so for the length of your trip, and in the process, you've reached some seriously relativistic speeds. As designed, the Valkyrie works more like a train of sorts, with the crew compartments and payloads suspended between two engines on a long tether, which has the effect of reducing the overall mass needed to build the ship by eliminating some of the radiation shielding needed, as the engines would produce gamma radiation. At these speeds, dust and debris in the interstellar medium would be a problem. Shielding from space debris is accomplished in this design by a dual-use radiator in front of the ship. Droplets of liquid heated by waste heat are sprayed in front of the ship, then they fall back down, cooled, back into the radiator for recycling, and the cloud of liquid in front of the ship has the effect of shielding. Unfortunately, the biggest problem with this design is the uncertainty over whether we could ever find a way to manufacture antimatter on a large scale. Tons would be needed, and it's currently only available in seriously minute quantities. Then, you have to contain the antimatter, which is quite hard. New technologies would be needed, and until that changes, if ever, this method cannot be pursued. Number 4, the Alcubierre Star Drive. This option has been thought about for a while, and if it's possible, it would allow not only interstellar propulsion, but intergalactic propulsion, faster-than-light travel, and shielding from the relativistic effects of traveling at high speed through the normal universe. The idea is that you circumvent the speed of light limit by effectively splitting off a piece of space-time around your spacecraft and accelerating it, and by proxy your ship, to faster-than-light speeds. The ship itself is actually not moving through space-time, it's sitting stationary on a piece of space-time that is moving. This is possible because space-time itself is not subject to the faster-than-light ban, and can, in principle, be made to propagate through the universe far faster than light. However, this option suffers from a bunch of problems people have thought of over the years. One of them is that you would need some serious energy to get it going, perhaps prohibitively so for most civilizations. But more recent thinking is shrinking this amount of energy further and further. Another issue is that you'd need negative matter, which is something that the universe does not prohibit from existing, but that's it. So it's not banned, but we have no clue how to make it, and there's no evidence that any of it exists naturally in our universe. Other problems include surviving the trip, which again, as discussion of the concept has progressed, problems have seemingly cropped up. But if it turns out possible, then warp engines from Star Trek will seem like bicycles in comparison to the Alcubierre drive. There doesn't appear to be a hard and fast upper speed limit for the drive, but there's also no guarantee you could figure out a way to slow it back down. But it would allow access to at least large swaths of the universe. Number 3, black hole starships. Intuitively, we might think that black holes are by their very nature inherently dangerous. And they are in certain situations, such as if you're falling into one. But they are also incredible objects that could, under the right circumstances, make for good propulsion systems. But in that case, you wouldn't want to use a natural black hole. Instead, you'd want to make an artificial one, and they are possible to make. Once you had a black hole, then you would use its Hawking radiation to propel the ship, essentially by creating a dish and directing the radiation. The materials needed to shield gamma radiation and build such a ship, it would generate a lot of heat, do not yet exist. But if they did, a 606 metric ton artificial black hole could produce 160 petawatts of energy. With that available energy, you could reach relativistic speeds in a matter of days. It's still being debated in physics whether using a black hole to power a starship is actually possible in practice, but it's not the only way you could use an astrophysical object to generate thrust. You can also use stars. This idea is relatively simple. Called a Shkedov thruster, it essentially involves building half a Dyson sphere, which then directs the star's output in one direction, thusly moving the star itself along with the thruster. At least initially, this is not a fast way to travel, it would take time, but a civilization that has nothing but time on their hands might employ the Shkedov thruster as a long-term star management system, moving them around to wherever they might wish. Number 2. Traversable Wormholes. The concept of a possible connection or tunnel to another part of the universe is an alluring one in science fiction because it's one of the few ways that the speed of light limit might be circumvented that's consistent with general relativity. It's the traversable wormhole, and while entirely hypothetical, there are objects in nature that may or may not actually be hosting wormholes, such as the singularity at the center of a black hole, or very tiny ones that form in the quantum foam. The problem with wormholes is that they don't really appear to be very traversable, but what could make them traversable is, once again, negative matter. A shell of negative matter might be able to hold a wormhole open, but it's somewhat unclear where you might end up. Would it take you to some other point in the universe? If so, what time period, as they also open up the possibility of time travel? In fact, Kip Thorne and colleagues advanced that a wormhole normally connecting two points in space could be turned into a time machine if you accelerate one of the openings, though you could never go back to a time before the wormhole existed. But there's another aspect. If you could somehow open a wormhole and hold it open and step through, you may not get what you expect. One last possibility for wormholes is that they might not lead to some other point in space-time, but rather an entirely different universe. This is a problem, because if other universes exist, they may have very different properties than this one. So stepping into a universe where matter can't exist in the form it does here, you may simply dissolve. Number 1. The Halo Drive. This option is a very recent addition to the list of possible star drives. In a recent paper by David Kipping, link below, and links to an in-depth video he did on the subject, and a recent interview I did with him on Event Horizon, he proposes using binary black holes as a method of propulsion. To make it work, you would fire a laser at the event horizon of one of the black holes just slightly above the surface. The gravity of the black hole would then warp the laser around to the other side, sending the beam back your way, but having increased the energy of the beam, blue shifting the light. This more energetic light could then be used for propulsion at relativistic speeds. This is a very efficient way to do it, since the only energy you need to invest in it is actually getting to the black hole itself. Once past that, the halo drive is effectively a free lunch. Also possible here is a method for slowing back down. If you travel from one set of binary black holes to another binary black hole system, you could use the halo drive in reverse to slow back down. This could allow for a network of binary black holes to serve as a sort of natural highway system throughout the Milky Way. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently giving a heads up again. In about 2 weeks from now on Event Horizon, my guest will be Dr. Miguel Alcubierre for a discussion on faster-than-light propulsion and other such topics. Going to be a good one. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.